Well, my name is Mark Powell. Welcome to AP's Profiles in Christian Living. I'm the convener of the National Journal for the Presbyterian Church of Australia. And it's my great honour and privilege to be able to interview guests from around Australia and indeed the world about their own faith in God and in particular Jesus and what it means to them. My special guest with me today is Mr. Ron Francis. Ron is, I think, one of Tasmania's and even Australia's leading artists. And we're going to talk to him today about spirituality, the divine, and the supernatural, and how it relates to art. Ron, welcome. It's great to have you with us.
Thank you very much. Very nice introduction for me, and hello.
Well, look, it's a great privilege and pleasure to be able to interview you. I want to talk about art and the supernatural. But before we just get to that, I want to refer to, I think, probably one of your most famous or well-recognised paintings.
Well-recognised is probably the best way to put it, yeah. It's been viral on the internet for maybe, is it 30 years now, in one form or another?
Yeah, it's so good. And I have to say to people, this is actually a painting because a lot of people I see on social media think that it's actually a photograph.
Which is strange for me. I've seen discussions where people are saying, oh, it's photoshopped because there aren't any telegraph wires going to the houses. And I'm thinking, can't you see it's paint? So it's really weird for me to think people think it's a real photo, but they do.
I mean, look, I'm not an artist myself, but I can appreciate the skill in which you have done this. I've had it on my desk for about a week now leading up to this interview, and I've just been looking at even just the water and thinking
the water,
patience that it must have taken to just do the water in this painting. But what do you think it is that resonates with people that they just look beyond the medium to the message itself?
Well, When I've read posts, people talking about it, so it usually comes up as something like why boys need mothers, and it's a bit jokey, but it allows people to talk about themselves or their kids or boast about how they would have done it or they've done it on a steeper street. So for me, it's a bit like that. There's no glory in it for me. It's just a vehicle for them to talk about themselves. It's simple as that.
Yeah, I think the idea, the image is just so immediately, it resonates with you because you remember your own childhood.
It was from a childhood memory. The street was not that steep. I made it 30 degrees, which is steeper than any street in the world, I believe. There's a street, I think the steepest street is in New Zealand and it's 23 degrees. Mm. So I had a memory where I got on a skateboard and I wanted to skate down this hill. It was somewhere on the north side of Sydney Harbour, and it was steep and I was scared and I went about 3 or 4 metres and jumped off. So that memory, I tried to distill it. I tried to exaggerate everything I do. So I tried to distill that memory and exaggerate it like as if I saw it when I was a kid, where it was larger than life.
Yeah, I've seen you do this with other paintings and I only wish I'd brought this example as well. You have three boys before a stormwater drain and you do some software modelling on the geometry of it. How important is that in the composition of your artwork?
You mean the software?
Yeah.
Geometry? I've written software over, must be 30, 35, 40 years now that developed from formulas that I use on a calculator, and that just develops slowly. And 3D graphics developed at the same time, and I was able to pick out formulas from that and incorporate it into mine. So mine grew and grew. I don't want to rely on it because if everything failed, we lost electricity, I wouldn't like to not be able to paint. So I try to keep in touch with all the perspective that I do. However, it allows me to do things that would be extremely difficult to do without it. It does all the perspective for me. So if I want to put a house in a certain, flying through the air or something, all the perspective points are done. So it is very important and I love it. I love programming. But I would hate to say that I would have to rely on it.
Now, I've got to be very careful here in this interview because there are so many technical sides of art that I'd love to talk to you about, but maybe we can talk to and address these as we go because I know you're somewhat of an expert and you're passionate about colour. So if I can just flag that, we'll talk about that as we go. But I want to talk to you about the spirituality and the supernatural that comes through in your artwork. So if I could start with, I think, probably the most personal question of all, and that is your own spiritual experience. And there's one particular artwork which I know is based on a dream that you yourself have had. Can you talk to us about this particular painting, what it represents, and how you came to paint it?
Yes, of course. Probably about 30 years ago, I started reading the Bible, and I read it from start to finish, and I read it with the intent to find mistakes in it or contradictions because I was tired of people telling me what I should be doing with my life. So I figured I could read it, and if I found a mistake or contradiction, I could throw it away and say, well, I'm finished with that. And it affected my heart. There was one scripture that I read, or one verse that I read, saying, if you look for me with your whole heart and obey my commandments, I'll show myself to you. And I thought, aha, I'm going to do that. And when you don't show yourself to me, I can throw the book away. And for about a year after that, I had extraordinary events occur, all to do with what I'd read. Nothing that was totally convincing until right at the end. But they were extraordinary. This painting was about a dream that I had where I was reading about the Jews exiting out of Egypt and complaining all the time, complaining, saying, why did you bring us here? And I'm thinking, look, these guys saw the Red Sea part. They see a flame traveling around. God's with them all the time. Are they stupid? What are they doing? Yeah. So I had this in my mind that, oh, if I was there, I wouldn't have done that. And then I had this dream and I was up in the clouds and God was in front of me and he was going to ask me a question and my life depended on the question. And I was thinking, oh, no, he's going to ask me a trick question and I'm going to die. And he finally asked me the question and he said, who's the Jew who's been softening your heart for this past year?
Wow.
And then I realised, oh, Jesus was a Jew. And I'm thinking all these bad things about Jews. So, oh, the question wasn't so hard at all. So that's what that was all about.
Yeah, but so let's look into this because everybody I show this picture to, I say, what do you see? And they go, oh, I see a man floating up into the clouds. I go, And then I say, look closer. And my son, who dabbles in art, went, that's brilliant. That's so hard to do, Dad.
Do they see it themselves?
They do after about 15 seconds when I say, look closer.
That's interesting, yeah.
And I wonder if those viewing it now can see it, which is the face in the clouds. So do you feel like for you, you were given your own personal epiphany?
I'm not sure about epiphany. I can say that it was very difficult to balance the face, because I didn't want it to become obvious, but I didn't want it to become lost. So getting back to epiphany, you're talking about the dream was an epiphany?
Yeah, a revelation that there's actually God, that there's a real God behind the supernatural that has revealed himself or drawn you to himself.
It wasn't until the end of my experience that I was finally totally convinced that God was real and that he was a personal God and that he loved me. At that point, I was just in a whirlwind of learning and feeling very heightened emotions, and that was very much a part of it.
Okay, so let's go to the next painting because I think this tells something of a story. And can I just say, I think for me, this is the one which is almost one of your darker paintings and in terms of its somberness. But for me, it's just the most intriguing. Talk us through what this painting means.
Well, it was a radio play. I cannot remember what it was about, but there was a very short segment which described a scene. This wasn't my idea. Maybe I've added parts. I can't remember. But the basic idea is this woman is so engrossed in her TV show. These three angels. These are angels you can see some.
I didn't realise they were until you pointed it out to me a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, they're a little bit subtle.
It's beautiful.
Obviously, the robes look like they're maybe holy people.
Exactly.
The wings are just like, oh, look at that.
I love the subtleness. It's more powerful.
They've not just walked in from outdoors or from a church somewhere. They're actually angels, and they're saying, look, you know, we've got an important message for you. And she's saying, no, get out of the road. I want to see this thing on TV. They haven't finished the questions yet. So that's what that was all about. And when I heard it on the radio play, it was such a strong image in my mind. I thought, yeah, I'll paint that.
Oh, I mean, it's incredible because, I mean, I think here that's got to be Ian Turpie, right, from The Price is Right.
I believe so, yeah.
But everybody knows their grandmother's place with that carpet.
Yeah, it's my carpet.
And I can almost smell, Ron, the mustiness and the dust and the old TV on the legs.
Oh, yeah.
And yet the supernatural is standing right in front of her and she doesn't see it.
That's why you picked the supernatural. That makes sense now.
Yeah.
Yeah, the idea of supernatural. Yes.
Well, it makes sense, but I mean, I think just the way, and the way that even their feet are pointing in towards her, it's subtle that they're trying to get her attention and yet she's trying to look around them.
They're patiently waiting for her as well. They're not, you know, saying, look, you've really got to do this. She goes, no, get out of the road. And they're just being patient and waiting. That was my idea, that they're not rushing her off. But ultimately it's her decision.
Well, again, I think this is what I really appreciate about your art, is it's not, I was going to say it's not heavy-handed in its presentation of its themes, but it is confronting. That's when you really look into this painting, and I just can't stop looking at it. It just draws me in. Some paintings you see and you think, oh, that's beautiful, and okay, that was a nice picture. But yours, it's almost message dominated or centered.
This comes down to the question that I wanted to ask you. Before you met me, before you knew that I was religious. Mm. What did you see in my work that it may have been religious? I mean, what was it about it that thought there was something there for you?
That's probably a really good segue to our next painting, and I'll explain, because it's a great question. And actually, I thought there was religious themes in your work, but to be honest, I was immediately attracted to the skill of it.
Thank you.
It really is just incredible art. But here's a good example of there must be more depth to you spiritually than many people would probably realise. So here's the famous scene from one of Jesus's own teachings: do not throw your pearls before swine, except you've given
almost
it your own Ron Francis
almost
spin.
Yeah.
Can you tell us what's going on in this scene?
Well, yes. I mean, I know the scripture well. So I can understand why you'd look at that and go, oh, he's spiritual because he knows that scripture. I have heard a lot of doctrine which I don't believe. So this painting represents one, the pearls before swine. The swine aren't going to know what the pearls are about, so it's a pointless exercise. But on the other hand, people that are peddling false, what I consider false doctrine, and they're desperate for people to believe it, I've made him a salesman and he's desperately trying to sell these pearls to the pigs. So it's a two-way street.
See, that's powerful. That's even more powerful than I gave it credit for.
Well, thank you.
Well, because I think there'd be a lot of people out there that know your work and love your work and I think would be really surprised and even shocked to know, wow, okay, he's religious. In fact, he believes in Jesus. He's a Christian. But they would go, oh, the church, you know. There's so many false things that I've heard and seen, or even false teachers that are just in it for money. How would you, can I just ask you a personal question there?
Sure.
Because I know that's been a journey for you too. Not everybody, like Jesus himself talks about, there's false prophets and true prophets.
Yeah, and beware of those that pray in public places.
You being preachy, what would you say to people that are saying, oh, look, I just want to write off the supernatural altogether because I've seen bad forms of religion? Oh, what would you say in response to that?
Well, when you mention the word Christianity, I'm a little bit wary of that. Mm. Not because of what Jesus taught or did, but because of all the bad things that people have done in the name of Christianity. Mm. Mm. But I guess if somebody was really interested, I would say, well, you can't blame God for that. God has let us run our course. And one story that I've told is if you got a man that says, I want to go and live on this island, he's got a wife and kids here. I want to go and live on this island. So he's talking to God and says, I want to go live over there. God says, look, don't do that. You'll end up in trouble. Mm. You'll run out of food. It's not good for you, because everything that God says is not for his benefit, it's for our benefit, right? So he says, no, look, there's plenty of food there. And he goes over there, and like three or four generations later, they start starving to death. The children of the children start starving to death. Whose fault is it? So Jehovah lets him go as a proof that we can't live without him. Mm-hmm. So I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, if I could just change track a little bit, because I know we've spoken before at length. Mm, yeah. We had a lovely two-hour chat over coffee down at beautiful Signet, one of the best towns in Tasmania, can I just say. And you were saying to me that often I say to you, how do you get these ideas? Can you talk about that process? Because sometimes you've said to me you've been lying in the sun and they just come out, you see the image in your head.
Pretty much.
And you just... Do you see, would you interpret that as a sense of almost divine inspiration? How do you understand
that? That's difficult. That's very difficult. I mean, who knows where thoughts come from in the first place? Mm. Who knows what consciousness is? All I can say is I believe that the things that I can do are God-given, so I can say that much. The inspiration of the ideas that I want to paint, I don't know where they come from. I could probably say that they're a product of the things that I see and hear, my past all welling up, fermenting in my mind somewhere. To say that those ideas are divine, I couldn't say that. I couldn't claim credit for being a voice for God.
Yeah, not in the sense of like... in divinely inspired, like somebody
exactly.
like, you know, in scripture.
Like the apostles.
But artists often talk about having a muse, you know, and I'm interested to understand your own. So there's belief in God, you know, which a lot of people might even be deists, like that God is the divine watchmaker that just winds up the universe and lets it run
impartial.
Its course. Impartial and somewhat distant. Mm. I would think, though, the sense I get in talking to you about your relationship with God and even how it's interacted with art is it's more imminent, in that God is much more involved in your life. In fact, I remember you saying to me over coffee that a prayer you often pray is, you know, God, what would you have me do?
Yeah, light my path. Show me. I often walking down to the yacht club and back down in beautiful Signet.
One of the best towns in Tasmania.
Because I hear a lot of things. I've been read books from Jehovah's Witnesses, and other things that I see on the internet, and it's really quite confusing because interpretations can be quite different. So my prayer is that please give me some Holy Spirit, enough Holy Spirit to give me enough wisdom to know the truth of what I hear and see and think. And as well as that, it's shine a light on the path that you want me to go, because really that's all I need to do.
And can I ask a personal question, if it's okay? How do you find God answering that prayer?
very sluggish. It reminds me of King David, King David's in Psalms, where he's saying, "Why are you ignoring me?" Basically, I can't paraphrase it. But he says, "Why, you know, I'm here in dire straits, and you're just ignoring him." Later on, he says, "Yeah, but you saved me, you saved me." Mm. So at the moment, I feel like I keep praying and keep praying and keep asking, and nothing much seems to be happening.
Yeah, I think sometimes the mystics used to refer to that kind of experience as the dark night of the soul.
I haven't heard of that.
There's times where, well, I'm preaching this week on Mark's gospel, where Jesus calms the storm and he's asleep in the back of the boat.
Yeah, he doesn't care.
All the disciples say, "Don't you care?" But we know all along, of course he cares. He's actually, I think, wanting to deepen their own trust in him.
Actually, if I can add to that, one thing that I do have, say when Jesus was sleeping in the storm, he wasn't worried about the storm. Mm. We are supposed to throw all our anxieties on God. Mm. And I do have that sense of calm. And that little story I told you over coffee, during that year of all the extraordinary events that were happening to me, one of them was that all of a sudden I needed $2,000 to work on my teeth. And I was on Social Security at the time, and I was lucky to have $20. And this had happened before with money too, but this was a big one. I walked out into my backyard and said, "Well, I'm doing my bit. I'm trying to do the commandments and follow you with my whole heart. This is now your problem because you promised you'd look after it." And I had such a sense of lack of care.
Peace?
Peace, you call it peace, but it wasn't my – I knew something inside of myself, knew it wasn't my problem anymore. Mm. And a couple of days later, I received $2,000 in the mail from an uncle that had recently died that I never knew. Mm. So I have learned to trust to an extent. So even though I feel like my prayers aren't being answered, at least how I expect them to be answered, I still feel that trust that everything's okay.
Mm. Yeah, excellent.
I'm being looked after.
Yeah, excellent. I'm going to talk you to another painting now. And again, I find a lot of people find this really confronting, because it's so beautiful and innocent and yet at the same time so dangerous. It's called Waking Leviathan.
That's right, yeah.
What's going on here?
We're talking about how our ideas ferment in my mind. This was inspired by people fiddling with the environment and not understanding how dangerous it is. So ultimately it's just, you know, factories spewing out stuff, just, well, we can do this and this and this, and being naive about how much damage they're doing. Mm. And somewhere along the line, that got converted into kids trying to poke a crocodile. Mm. So, yeah, it's a fairly simple concept, I suppose, but I guess what I'm trying to do in most cases is distill an idea down to something that hopefully is eternal, that we can all understand.
Interesting.
So rather than making some statement about factories spewing out stuff, it ended up being a couple of kids that we all know are naive, and we all know a crocodile is going to, you know.
See, really, that's fun. Really interesting, because you're talking about eternal ideas, right?
Yes.
And do you find in your art you start with the idea or you start with the image?
Tough question. Very tough question. I'll answer it with another example. And this was after I had cancer about 20 years ago, and it gave me a very different perspective on life. And one vision, if I could call it that, at that time was, we're all on a sphere hurtling through space. No one knows where we're going. No one knows where we're coming from. And people are just walking around buying and selling like as if everything's normal. So to me, this was totally absurd. And that ended up somehow, and I'm not sure how, this is the magic of thought, somehow that ended up being a lifeboat from the Titanic with people in it, very calm water in a fog, so you couldn't see very far into the distance. They basically didn't know where they were going to or coming from, but they were having a party. So it somehow it went from the world, which I couldn't paint a world hurtling through space with a whole lot of little people on it, but somehow the essence was the same, that these people are lost in the middle of the sea, but they're oblivious to the problem and they're just having a party.
Well, there's an imminent danger. We all know what happens with the Titanic.
Well, they're in the lifeboat after.
Ah, okay. Let me show you another painting. So in this painting, Ron, tell us, what's it about?
Well, everyone's heard the term King of the Hill.
Mm.
I'm not sure where it came from, but my idea, and it's probably very different from how you think of it, maybe, is that he's lording it over the hill, but there's nothing there. So he's king of nothing.
That's what I thought you meant. It's like Ozymandias, you know, there's a famous poem by Shelley called Ozymandias.
I don't know it.
This Egyptian king that rules over all the sand dunes.
Yes, perfect.
And I thought that's exactly what you're saying. But can I say I think there's an eternal truth here. Now, I'm being very postmodern, Ron.
Go for it.
And but for me, this represents Jesus as the king of the harvest. Because
I can see that, yeah.
You can.
Yeah, well, it's wheat.
Well, it is, but it's abundant wheat. It's like the parable of the soils in Mark 4.
Yeah, it's got found good soil.
This is where I want to stay with me, audience, because I actually want to drill down on your art here, because if you look carefully at this, this is incredible art. To paint a wheat field like that is phenomenal. Well, it's not just a bare hill. You know, this is an abundant harvest. Can I just say, technically, as an artist, Ron, how do you do that?
Well, with difficulty sometimes. I had never painted wheat before, and there were certain problems where sizes, it comes forward and do I do the wheat first and then the shadows? Do I do the shadows of wheat? Do I do in the middle? Do shadows? So I was fumbling around with this one quite a lot. But if you're actually asking me how do I do it with a paintbrush, how can I tell you without showing you?
How did you learn your trade?
Oh, that's another story. For some reason when I was young, I could draw and other people couldn't. Well, not as well. I thought not as well. And I didn't stop. I think most kids will draw. For me, I remember in fourth class at school, a specific event where I was drawing a tree, and for some reason I started shading it from dark to light, dark on one side. I thought, oh, I can make it look round. So it was discovery, and that happened all the way through my art. It was all discovery. I did go to Julian Ashton Art School for 3 months. That's in Sydney in the Ronks, and they taught me absolutely nothing, no tuition at all. No, not one person said anything. So I was on my own. I learned a lot from photography books. Mathematics plays a big part to do with, how much light is bouncing off a surface and, the radiance from that. So a lot of it was just discovery, but not in places where people would normally learn painting from.
Yeah, I find that incredible. There's so many questions I want to ask you at this point because, I think... And I'm sorry, I feel like such a fan, like in gushing about it because I just do. That's right. I actually think you're actually one of the things that strike me about you is you're very meek and humble.
I've got that story about when I went into the studio that
Please tell.
Okay, this humbled me a long time ago because self-importance is a real snare. I remember one time I walked into my studio. I had tears in my eyes and I was thanking God that I could do something that I loved doing and that I could do it so well. The very next morning I walked into my studio and it was like a veil had been lifted from my eyes and I could see how rubbish it was,
wow.
How totally amateurish it was. Lucky that didn't last very long. But it made me realise I can't tell. I'm no judge. I can imagine someone playing a violin beautifully, but it's so slightly out of tune and God would listen to it and he would hear that out of tuneness.
Mm.
So that put me back in my place well and truly.
See, again, that's fascinating because you're talking about the supernatural breaking in on you as an artist in very surprising ways.
Yeah, well, that's fair enough. That was a supernatural, well, I suppose it was supernatural. It was certainly an experience that I attributed to a supernatural cause.
Mm, yeah. I mean, it's got to be supernatural when it humbles us, you know, because I think by nature we're proud and we're puffed up with our own self-importance. Now, I know that you are an expert in colour and you're passionate about that. Can you explain why and that is such a passion for you?
Oh, it's magic. I mean, even the way our brains decipher colour is magic. We don't actually see colour. We make it up in our minds. One thing you may have heard, for example, is magenta. Doesn't exist. It's not in the spectrum, but we make it up. And there are certain things that happen where it's called colour constancy, I think I've got that right, where you may have a colour that looks, say, brown if you isolate it, but then you put it into context in a painting and it'll change. It'll change to a green or something like that. I know these things well and I predict them when I paint. So I calculate what colour I need to mix to look a certain colour under a certain light. But I'm constantly surprised that it works. And I used to test people, like my son, for example. I'd be painting a white wall, for example. We haven't got an example here. and the white wall was in shadow, but it was lit by a cyany blue sky and there was also light bouncing up from the grass, so it was green. And I painted that first and it was very, very green. And I was talking to my son, so, well, that's going to look white in the end, or I'm going to try to make it look white in the end. And even myself, it was so hard to believe that it was going to work. And he said, no, it's impossible, you know, that's just too green. And then when all the rest of the painting was filled in, it looked white.
So can I ask you a philosophical question here? And I'm sorry if this is a dumb question, but I'm intrigued to see what you'd say. A lot of people would say you can tell that there's a creator by the sheer beauty of the creation, right? The orderliness, the intricacy of, I've known doctors that have said they've become Christians simply by looking at the human eye.
Yeah.
That just couldn't not be an accident.
Yeah, many.
But I want to go just down to an even more basic level, and this is basic for all artists. Do you think colour, just colour, is a reflection of the divine?
Reflection of the divine. I mean, everything is you can look at anything in microscopic detail and go, well, there's nothing there but pure energy. I say yes. What surprises me about colour is if you look at the visible spectrum, it's just wavelengths. Yet when you go into the infrared, it becomes heat. We feel it as heat, but it's part of the same spectrum. And that, to me, just boggles my mind that we can be made to all of a sudden be able to experience a different part of the spectrum. It's very, very close to the visible spectrum as something completely different. So, yes, I just think it's amazing.
And can you just, for our listeners, just talk about what your interest in colour is and what you're trying to develop and what you're trying to explore.
Oh, with colour? Mm. Colour is just a means to an end for me. The bottom line is I want to be able to express in paint some image that I may have dreamt or thought of and try to make it as realistic as possible, like as if I took a photograph of it. So to do that, colour has become important, because if I get a colour wrong and it doesn't look real, it's just going to make the painting look wrong. So in the same way as computer graphics, when you see computer graphics like an animated movie, if the colours were wrong, it just look wrong. So it's nothing specific about colour. I mean, I love colour, but there's nothing specific about colour that I work towards. No, I'm saying that badly. I don't paint because I love colour. I paint because I can express feelings and emotions and ideas, and I use colour.
But it's colour that gives it colour, isn't it? It's colour that gives it meaning.
I wouldn't say that, no.
No?
I know, because I could do a black and white painting and hopefully I wouldn't lose the meaning.
Interesting.
Colour certainly gives its own energy. So I wouldn't, you know, relegate it to, oh, it's just an added little thing. Colour is just spectacular.
You talk about, again, this gets back to the message and the medium, and you think of an idea or you get a dream and you're wanting to paint it. What's the next project for Ron Francis? What are you interested in painting?
I have several ideas and there's nothing concrete. One idea is to do with indoctrination, where I have a hall. I've started drawing some pictures for this, and I've started modelling some stuff. So it's in process, but it's a hall where there are men in suits, and another man in jeans and a t-shirt. And one of the men in suits is ushering him in with his hand on his back, saying, "Yeah, come with us, come with us. This is great." And the man in the jeans is sort of like a bit hesitant, but he's still following. So it has to do with, I think, indoctrination. Is that the best word I can use?
Indoctrination can be negative, but it can also, I think, be positive.
Oh yeah.
In fact, I feel like this painting could be a bit surreal. I'm thinking I'm in a suit and you're in jeans. I'm a pastor and you're a follower or somebody who believes in Jesus. Thinking, this could be very almost prophetic or at least prescient. But my job as a pastor is actually to
save people.
Well, to I
make
guess,
disciples. Sorry.
Yeah, that's right. It's God who saves. I'm not the king of the hill. For me, Jesus is the king of the hill, but the harvest is very much his work.
He makes it grow.
Exactly. But it's a fascinating concept. I'd love to see it when it's done. What have you got a time frame for when you think you'll be completed?
No, not at all.
Mm.
It's a very difficult one. For me, it's probably darker than what you're imagining, because I do have, there's probably about four, five, six, seven men in suits.
Mm.
So they've all become, what's a good word for it? They're all the same. I mean, they're different shapes, but they're all the same. They're all dressed the same. So they're following a doctrine. It could be good, could be bad. I'm not sure. There's nothing. I'm not making a statement about whether it's good or bad.
Yes.
It's a personal thing where, for me, it has a lot to do with Jehovah's Witnesses, for example.
Right.
Where I'm going, oh, hold on.
And they're forcing you to conform.
Not forcing me.
Ah.
Inviting me with a little bit of...
the old velvet...
Encouragement.
The steel hand in the velvet glove.
They don't do that. They certainly encourage.
Okay.
But they encourage in a certain way that can be... not forceful, but certainly feeling like you're being ushered.
Is the concept of your art finished, as in the whole framing of it, before you start, or does it develop?
No, pretty much. There are areas that aren't resolved that I'll attack while I'm painting, But as a concept, it's pretty much finished before I start.
Yeah, there was a couple of other paintings that you've done which I just think are so fascinating. There's what particularly one where you're in a boat. There's a man and a woman in a boat.
Oh, yes.
And they're coming down this... It's called Marriage, is it?
It's about marriage.
Ah.
I can't remember what I called it, but it's about marriage.
It's just riding the rough seas of marriage?
Yeah, yeah. And, of course, I exaggerated. It's a mountain of a wave.
Oh, yeah.
They're just trying to somehow negotiate the side of the wave somehow by, you know, going diagonally rather than straight down. And they're having a hard time, but they're getting through it.
Mm. In fact, there's another, it's a powerful painting that you've done with this beautiful 1950s housewife standing at the front of her, you know, house. And her parents are coming up the driveway, and inside the door is just creaked open, and there's a furnace blazing inside. Mm. Again, I think the meaning here is obvious that sometimes we put on a facade.
Very much a facade, yeah. Yeah.
But
she's trying to hide the fact that there's a furnace inside. Yeah. She doesn't want to upset her parents.
Yeah.
But, the inside of her life, the inside of her house is just a furnace, as you said. Yeah. There was a brilliant film, Desolation Road, I think it was called, that did that so well. The way that two people can fight each other they're not actually fighting, but it becomes like a cesspool of something really horrible. But to everyone else, they look fine.
Now, I'm sure a lot of people listening to this and watching this are intrigued now to think, what is this picture? If people want to see your artwork, if they want to see the originals, where do they go?
The originals are gone. No, they were sold long ago. So you can't see any originals unless you happen to know someone who's bought one of my paintings. Probably the best, you can find me on Facebook. If you look for Ron Francis on Facebook. Otherwise, my website has got everything, not everything, but most of the pictures that I've ever done, which is www.ronaldfrancis.com.
Okay, not Ron, but Ronald.
Ronfrancis.com is an American wiring company.
Don't go there.
So unless you want wiring.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Well, look, thank you so much. It's been a great pleasure. What is it? Can I just ask one final question?
Of course.
What is it about Signet and artists? Because, you know, we've got yourself down there. We've got Richard Stanley down the road.
There are a lot of artists there, and I have no idea. I remember when I was first moving down here, trying to work out where I was going to live, I was looking at Franklin and Signet, and they were both options. And for some reason, I looked at Signet and said, no, I want to live there. I don't know why, but there's something just drew me to it. And it may be just that the landscape, it's like a little hamlet and sort of like safe there rather than, say, Franklin. It's just got hills and then it's water.
Mm.
I don't know, but there are lots and lots of artists there. There are lots of strange individuals there. But from my point of view, from my perspective, people seem to be accepting of everyone. It's probably a delusion, but it suits me to have that delusion.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for joining us. It's been a great pleasure.
It's been my pleasure as well. Thank you.
Well, this has been Mark Powell for AP's Profiles in Christian Living. I hope you've enjoyed this episode as much as I have, and I look forward to seeing you next time.